Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Tropic of Orange by Karen Tei Yamashita, read by Emily Wu Zeller. Introduction by Seshu Foster. This is the ultimate book about Los Angeles, because there's no ultimate book about Los Angeles. There's no last stop on the LA Railway whose yellow trolleys went out of service in 1958. There's no end to Oaxacans, Zapotecs, Mixtecs, Central Americans, and Bengalis inventing new lives in Koreatown. No one's heading to the Ambassador Hotel on Wilshire to disrupt the assassination of Robert F. Kennedy. There's no end to white hipsters and creative types coming to Los Angeles from NYC and points east to make it big. Just like there's no last off-ramp on the 10 freeway heading across the desert to Texas and Florida. Which is to say, as the last city of the American civilization before the Pacific Plate subducts under North America and uplifts the ranges of the West, L.A. never stops. It never stops. L.A. never stops. Tropic of Orange dares to go there. L.A.'s the city at the end of the continent that grinds out industrial daydreams and nightmares for the rest of the planet. Hollywood will not rot on the windmills of eternity. Hollywood, whose movies stick in the throat of God, Allen Ginsberg wrote. Money, 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 shrieking mad celestial money of illusion. This city industrialized the imagination of the species. This city unspooled reels of Buster Keaton and W.C. Fields, killed Sam Cooke and Janis Joplin, buried Marilyn Monroe in the shadows of 10,000 Indians, Japanese, and Vietnamese who dared to attack John Wayne and his cohort of innocents. Driving Route 66 to the edge of the continent, L.A. arrived at the end of the world first. Giant ants, earthquakes, aliens from outer space. The city limits. The outer limits. Time and again, even as it was wiped out by Martians in 1953 in the War of the Worlds, or in 1971 when Charlton Heston drove the empty avenues of downtown in the Omega Man looking for vampires to machine gun, the city plowed the civilization's subconscious and planted alien pod plants. Roman Polanski's 1974 noir classic, Chinatown, ostensibly set in 1937, makes no mention, of course, that in 1936, most of Chinatown was razed and buried under the newly built Union Station. Dodger Stadium commemorates in no way the Chicano neighborhood of Chavez Ravine, whose residents were forcibly evicted, whose properties were buried under landfill for baseball parking lots. Entire Japanese-American neighborhoods were emptied of residents for concentration camps during World War II. East San Pedro Japanese-American residents were given 48 hours to pack and leave, their fishing village then razed, their boats sold or burned. Entire Mexican-American neighborhoods were razed and buried under famous freeways. Displacement, dispossession, and dislocation continues these days under the guise of gentrification. These are stories that Hollywood can't seem to imagine, because they're actually happening. Look in vain for them in Chinatown, Blade Runner, Shortcuts, L.A. Confidential. The ostensibly intergalactic imagination of the movies doesn't begin to approach hard-bitten realities reflected in the lives of the seven characters central to Tropic of Orange. Tropic of Orange refracts the city's passion like skyscrapers against the setting sun. This book holds in solar heat like a piece of granite. Even as the desert east of the San Gabriel Mountains refracts the city's energy like dream lightning in murky dreams of ex-LA hipsters, gentrified out to Joshua Tree, in sun-bleached dreams of old rock guitarists and rock climbers, as wind scours trinkets of aluminum and plastic across the sand and gravel. Out there, across the sand and gravel of his artist's compound, Noah Purifoy's human-scale monuments broadcast South Central passion to the Choya, the creosote, and the stars. Out there, young Black and Latino families from the Marine base shop at the Yucca Valley Walmart. Out there, errant music recorded in L.A. wafts like lost heat waves. Those lyrics, those phrases and rhythms reemerge inscribed in these sentences, in these chapters. The revolution will not be televised, recalls Tropic of Orange on page 187. Even as a romantically entangled Chicano and Japanese-American couple, journalists tragically tried to prove it wrong. If L.A. is that recombinant hybrid of the culture's imagination and the civilization's final history, of its weird and frequently terrible desires taken to their ultimate logical ends, freeways and car culture, cults and crazies, a police state hidden behind sunglasses and suntans. Few novels live to tell actual Los Angeles stories and effectively take anything like its full measure. Tropic of Orange takes that apocalyptic tale on with surrealist nerve and futurist verve. Karen Yamashita looks on what the civilization wrought on this place, unafraid. She doesn't turn away. 5 years after the 1992 riots, the largest civil disturbance in modern times, 60 dead, $1 billion damage, columns of smoke still rise from those conflicts of race and class. Seven voices, each distinguished by a distinct voice and POV, tell stories that sojourn the Pacific, traverse the Sonoran Desert, cross mean streets and ethnic divides to meet, folding into one another in a wild and wildly imagined 7 days in Los Angeles. In 2011, as a visiting professor of creative writing at UC Santa Cruz, I wandered into the lunch counter at a cafe that Karen liked and found her hosting a party of out-of-town visitors. She invited me to join them, and as I pulled up a chair, one of the visitors, Robert Allen, was talking about the Port Chicago Mutiny, the largest mass mutiny in U.S. naval history, when 50 black sailors were court-martialed in 1944 after 700 men were blown apart, 320 died, loading munitions aboard ships heading for the war in the Pacific. "Robert," I said, jumping up, "you're the only person I've ever heard talking about Port Chicago." I ran over and gave him a hug. "The last time I saw you was in Nicaragua. How long has it been? 20 years? He'd written a book about Port Chicago and edited the Black Scholar Journal for decades. I'd learned about Port Chicago more than 20 years earlier and more than 3,000 miles away, in Managua, in 1987, when Robert told me about it as we sat at a table with Alice Walker. I've only heard the story of Port Chicago twice in my life, both times by luck. The kind of luck and the kind of stories you get when Karen Yamashita invites you to sit at her table. Tropic of Orange invites you. Try your luck. Pull up a chair or just listen to this book. You're in for 7 kinds of LA stories that fold into an origami flower of razor-sharp titanium. A city named after sacred but imaginary beings. An estate named after a paradise that was the figment of a woman's dream. A city that came to fame by filming such figments. A city existing now on sufferance from the ever-hotter desert and the ever-rising sea, and that feels every day, to so many of us, like a mirage as it waits for its great quake. Its suffering is real enough, God knows, but its beauty is the beauty of letting things go. Letting go of where you came from. Letting go of old lessons. Letting go of what you want for what you are. Or what you are for what you want. Letting go of so much. And that is a hard beauty to love. Michael Ventura, Grand Illusion. Letters at 3 a.m., reports on endarkenment. It's against the law in California to walk on the freeways, but the law is archaic. Everyone who walks, walks on the freeways sooner or later. Freeways provide the most direct routes between cities and parts of cities. Some prostitutes and peddlers of food, water, and other necessities live along the freeways in sheds or shacks or in the open air. Beggars, thieves, and murderers live here, too. The freeway crowd is a heterogeneous mass. Black and white, Asian and Latin, whole families are on the move with babies on backs or perched atop loads in carts, wagons, or bicycle baskets, sometimes along with an old or handicapped person. Many were armed with sheathed knives, rifles, and, of course, visible holstered handguns. The occasional passing cop paid no attention. People get killed on freeways all the time. Octavia Butler, Parable of the Sower. Standing on the map of my political desires, I toast to a borderless future. I raise my glass of wine toward the moon. With our Alaskan hair, our Canadian head, our U.S. torso, our Mexican genitalia, our Central American cojones, our Caribbean sperm, our South American legs, our Patagonian feet, our Antarctic nails. Jumping borders at ease, jumping borders with pleasure. Amen. Hey, man. Guillermo Gomez Peña, Free Falling Toward a Borderless Future, The New World Border. Gentle reader, what follows may not be about the future, but is perhaps about the recent past, a past that, even as you imagine it, happens. Pundits admit it's impossible to predict, to chase such absurdities into the future, but say LAV. No single imagination is wild or crass or cheesy enough to compete with the collective mindlessness that propels our fascination forward. We were all there. We all saw it on TV, screen, and monitor. Larger than life. Chapter 1. Midday. Not too far from Mazatlan. Rafaela Cortez spent the morning barefoot, sweeping both dead and living things from over and under beds, from behind doors and shutters, through archways, along the veranda, sweeping them all across the deep shadows and luminous sunlight carpeting the cool tile floors. Her slender arms worked the broom industriously through the air, already thickening with tepid heat, and along the floor, her feet following, printing their moisture in dark footprints over baked clay. Every morning, a small pile of assorted insects and tiny animals, moths and spiders, lizards and beetles, collected, their brittle bodies tossed in waves along the floor, a cloudy hush of sandy soil, cobwebs, and human hair. An iguana, a crab, and a mouse. And there was the scorpion, always dead, its fragile back broken in the middle. And the snake that slithered away at the urging of her broom, probably not poisonous, but one never knew. Every morning it was the same. Every morning she swept this mound of dead and wiggling things to the door and off to the side of the veranda and into the dark green undergrowth with the same flourish. Occasionally there was more of one species or the other, but each somehow always made its way back into the house. The iguana, the crab, and the mouse, for example, were always there. Sometimes they were dead. Sometimes they were alive. As for the scorpion, it was always dead. But the snake was always alive. On some days it seemed to twirl before her broom, communicating a kind of dance that seemed to send a visceral message up the broom to her fingertips. There was no explanation for any of it. It made no difference if she closed the doors and shutters at the first sign of dusk, or if she left the house unoccupied and tightly shut for several days. Every morning when the house was thrown open to the sunlight, she knew that she and the boy had not slept alone that night. Hummingbirds and parakeets fluttered across the rooms, stirring the languid humidity settled by the night, frantically searching for escape through the open lace curtains, while crawling lives hid beneath furniture or presented itself lifeless at her feet. When she first came to the house, she couldn't find a broom to accomplish this daily ritual, not to mention for sweeping the clouds of cobwebs from the dark, rough-hewn rafters. Gabrielle had left an American vacuum cleaner in a closet, an old steel Electrolux purchased at the Rose Bowl swap meet for $30. When the electricity wasn't shut off, Rafaela dragged the vacuum, the hard bakelite wheels bumping over the clay tiles and the woven throw rugs, from one room to the next, but soon depleted Gabrielle's supply of vacuum bags. Recycling these bags was nearly impossible, and she did not have the heart to dump them without releasing the trapped animals inside. One day, attempting to use the vacuum cleaner without the bags resulted in jamming the gears with pieces of the crab, not to mention everything else. And that was the end of the Electrolux. When Rafaela told Gabrielle that the Electrolux had died, there was an uncomfortable silence on the other end of the line. probably because Gabrielle had had some idea that a stainless steel vacuum cleaner was something incredibly wise to have in the salty humidity of Mazatlan, and also because he had lugged it 1,000 miles on one particularly sacrificial trip, made in a borrowed Volkswagen van. The story about the crab seemed unlikely. His land was much too far from the sea. Yes, it sounded impossible, but why would Rafaela make such a thing up? "I bought a broom," she said, pressing the back of her hand against the sweat of her forehead. "If things get better between us, maybe I can get one of those upright vacuums from Bobby. Actually, a dry wet vac would be best. Bobby swears by them."
"Don't worry about it,"
Gabriel shrugged.
"Did you talk to Rodriguez?"
"Yes, he's coming over tomorrow, maybe with some help. He's going to put the windows in the bathroom and fix the tiles so the door will close. And I got him to come down in price." Rafaela tried to sound professional. She wanted Gabriel to know that despite breaking his vacuum, she could be a very good housekeeper. She was also very good with money matters and managing workers. Well, she came with good experience. Hadn't she been doing this for Bobby all along? She would have his place fixed up in no time. "Don't worry. You're gonna have a really nice place to retire to someday."
"Retire? I can't wait that long,"
moaned Gabrielle. The project had already been going on for 8 years. It had begun one summer when Gabrielle felt a spontaneous, sudden passion for the acquisition of land, the sensation of a timeless vacation, the erotic tastes of chili pepper and salty breezes, and for Mexico. And there had been one additional attraction, the location. It was marked exactly by a sign on the highway shoulder beyond the house. Tropic of Cancer. In Gabriel's mind, the tropic ran through his place like a good metaphor. If it were good enough for the tropic, it was good enough for Gabriel. He put his entire savings down and every cent he could spare on top of that. In the beginning, he went every summer, every free weekend, but the cost of travel, the headache of fighting the bureaucracy to get the right paperwork, and the difficulty in finding building materials and good construction workers frayed his original passion. Even though he tried, he was not a hands-on sort of person. He didn't understand plumbing, foundation work, masonry, electrical wiring, or even gardening. After all, he was a journalist. He just wanted a quiet place to write. Maintenance was the problem. And speaking the language was not enough. Everyone could tell he was green and took advantage of it. The workers, who all eventually abandoned their work, smiled graciously and wondered at this young Chicano who had a college education and whose grandfather had fought with Pancho Villa and ended up in Los Angeles. Nobody remembered the grandmother who supposedly came from right around there, a little girl who got kidnapped by the grandfather and taken away north. Some people pretended to remember or suggested that so-and-so might remember. They felt bad because he seemed so sure and proud about it. Still, the project continued in alternating states of disarray or progress. He seemed to be building a spacious hacienda, maybe a kind of old-style ranchero, circa 1800, with rustic touches, thick adobe-like walls and beams, but with modern appliances. But then again, finishing depended on having money and being able to translate his vision to others. He showed the workers scraps of photos torn from slick architectural magazines. Tilework, hot tubs, wet bars, arches, decks, and landscaping. Everyone agreed his ideas were all very beautiful. Old-fashioned, but beautiful. The plans expanded, then diminished, swelled with possibility, then shrank with reality. It seemed that if he took one step forward, he would then take two backwards. After 8 years, the house, the part that was finally constructed, needed painting again. The metal window insets he had gotten for such a good price were rusting and probably needed to be replaced with aluminum, and the doors were full of termites. Now Rafaela was there. Gabrielle was doing her a favor, letting her hide with her little son until she and her husband Bobby could make up their minds about their marriage. In return, She was going to help finish what his romantic impulse had begun. Rafaela was from Culiacán, 30 miles north of Mazatlan. About the time Gabriel was buying a piece of the Tropic of Cancer, Rafaela was crossing the border north. In 8 years, while his Mexican project floundered, she had learned English, married Bobby, helped start their janitorial business, born a baby, and got a degree at the local community college. She was smart, savvy, and eager to take on the tasks at hand. Gabriel couldn't ask for better. If this didn't work, he was going to have to sell the place, probably to another romantic tourist, and try to at least make back what he put into it. "I planted more cactus and peppers today, and my herbs and sunflowers are blooming all over," she announced. "And yesterday I went into town to price some toilet bowls and fixtures. You won't believe what they're asking. Maybe you ought to check out the prices over there. I'm going to make a list, and the next time you come down..."
"You want me to bring toilet bowls down from L.A.?"
"Well, since you've got this gigantic cistern dug and the piping is all copper, maybe..." "Well, you know what Bobby says. You get what you pay for. Except that's not really true here. But I just want to save you some money." Gabriel thought about toilet bowls and his money. It sounded crazy, but he knew she was probably right. He wanted to ignore the toilet bowls and said instead,
"Don't worry about the fixtures. I ordered some from a catalog and mailed them down. You should be getting them any day now."
"Mail? Are you sure that's wise?"
"It's the chance you take."
"My brother Pepe comes down all the time, you know. The last time he brought me some things from Culiacán, from my mother, to dress up the house. Knickknacks."
"From your mother?"
"It's nothing at all. She wants you to have them, just to make things pretty. Why don't you send me some copies of House Beautiful or Sunset? I can get some good ideas."
"House Beautiful?"
Gabriel seemed to choke on the other end. "Anyway, you could send stuff with Pepe. He really fills up his Chevy, and maybe he has some room. If you pay the gas, maybe he will come down this far."
"Maybe. How is Sol?"
"Kid's okay. I don't know how to thank you."
"Forget it."
Rafaela hung up the phone and nodded to Doña Maria, who was playing with Sol. "He's such a dear," Doña Maria cooed at the little boy. "He's got a little of your curly hair and your coloring. But really, he's such a little Chinese," she marveled. "A true mixture." "Yes," admitted Rafaela, pushing back the dark waves of her bushy hair, then combing her fingers through her son's. "He really looks like his daddy." She looked wistfully at Sol and thought about Bobby. Lately, she found herself talking to an invisible Bobby, consulting the air about this or that as if he were there. Bobby was such a handyman. He would have shaped up Gabriel's place in half the time. "So your mother was born in Culiacán?" Doña Maria was digging for information. "No, she was born in the Yucatán. And my father's people came from even farther south, Ayacucho in the Andes. They say my great-great-grandfather brought his family across the mountains and through the jungles to get here. But that was a long time ago."
"The old-timers knew how to endure."
"They say my mother's people were weavers, and my father's people built the looms. They couldn't talk to each other at first. They talked through their weaving and fell in love." Rafaela remembered that she and Bobby couldn't talk much at first either. But Bobby learned fast. He had already been fluent in some kind of Chicano street talk, but she herself had never bothered to learn Chinese. Maybe she should have.
"Such pretty stories."
The old woman nodded as if they weren't true.
"But why did your people leave the Yucatán?"
"One day the weaving stopped. The looms were old. The work was slow."
"Times changed," Doña Maria sighed. "And did you learn to read palms from your mother?" she asked.
"Oh, no," Rafaela smiled. "I don't know why I read palms. I've always just done so."
"Lupe says you are very good at it."
"It's just nonsense. Something to pass the time," Rafaela demurred.
Perhaps Doña Maria wanted her palm red, but Rafaela had a strange intuition. She did not want to read the woman's palm. Doña Maria did not press her, but commiserated.
You look a little tired today. It's a big headache, believe me, I know. My son went crazy building this place for us, and then Benito died, God rest his soul. He only saw the foundation. Now such a big house for one old woman. But at least when my son was building it, he was always there, back and forth, back and forth. Now I only get phone calls. But I thank God for this telephone.
Please let me know how much it is when the bill comes, Doña Maria. Rafaela took the boy's hand.
Oh, I almost forgot. My son sent me new chairs.
Doña Maria pointed to two rather ornate blue velvet cushioned pieces with shiny wood knobs and feet.
But it's such a shame. The old chairs are perfectly new. And I wondered if they might be of any use to you. That house could use some chairs, of course.
Rafaela thought about the old chairs that were, as Doña Maria said, practically new. If she remembered correctly, they weren't much different from the new chairs, except they had brass knobs and feet. She wondered about this decorating scheme, but before she could say anything, Doña Maria offered,
I will have Lupe send them over. You will see. They are just what the house needs.
Rafaela didn't want to offend the woman by saying no, and after all, chairs were needed. Gabrielle had talked about leather and carved dark wood benches. Not very comfortable, but then again, blue velvet was probably not his preference. Well, he could get rid of them later.
Thank you, she said. Of course. Please, any time at all. We are neighbors. Well, it's a little far, but you are just across the highway. I have always told Gabrielle, any time at all. He used to walk all the way to the hotel. I have nothing against the hotel, but then again, it's not such a nice hotel. Well, we don't get the tourists like Mazalan. But that's why my son and Gabrielle, too, like it here. They say it's quiet, away from the commotion. But I do get lonely.
Rafaela smiled. She knew Doña Maria preferred to stay in Mazatlan with her sister, but put off her plans just to be around to check out Rafaela and this story that she was some sort of housekeeper for Gabrielle. Offering the use of her telephone was a perfect way to get information. And perhaps Doña Maria thought Rafaela would be lonely in that big unfinished house on that big unfinished property. But Rafaela had been too relieved to be away from her problems with Bobby and kept too busy to feel very lonely. To be able to sweep with a broom across tile was somehow a very satisfactory thing. So much better than pushing the noisy vacuum over dull carpets from office to office. How could she explain this to Bobby? This wasn't just dust. It was alive. Rafaela and Little Soul crossed the two-lane highway, walked along the barbed wire fence on the west side, passing a group of cows absently chewing their cud, big green plops of fresh dung steaming everywhere. She went to check the fencing where Gabrielle's property began. The cows had tramped over a fallen post and into the garden, destroying Gabrielle's lattice with the wild roses. Not that it had looked that beautiful, but it was a nice idea. Probably one of Gabrielle's magazine cutouts. Now the roses were twisting along the ground and up a banana tree. The idea of having fruit trees was a nice one, too, except that the soil was sandy and required a lot of dung and compost. Every day, Rafaela threw kitchen leftovers and fallen fruit into the trough at the bottom of the banana tree. It knew how to make use of fresh refuse. But composting trees like peach and plum was a more delicate business. Over the years, Gabrielle had planted an orchard full of different trees. He had a thing about planting a tree every time he came. He tried not to be discouraged when they died, telling Rafaela,
"They gotta take care of themselves. Survival of the fittest."
Needless to say, the fittest were the mango and papaya trees.
At this time of year, their fruit rotted in steaming ditches everywhere. The sweet stench floated above the earth, swirling around, as Rafaela's body cut a meandering path through the garden. Wondering why Gabrielle insisted on planting trees that couldn't survive in this climate. Evidence of their dried twigs supporting creeping vines and hidden behind the now robust vegetation was everywhere. She planted cactus and sunflowers, chilies and corn, kitchen and medicinal herbs. Still, she was hoping to make some miracle happen in this orchard, just to surprise Gabrielle. Produce from his exotic northern trees. A sweet, gooey marmalade from his orange trees, perhaps. But perhaps not. The variety of citrus trees was commendable. Italian blood oranges, mandarins, valencias, Mexican limes, their green foliage spreading like a rich blanket across the land. But Rafaela was only concerned about one tree in particular. It was a rather sorry tree. Yellowing, perhaps from lack of some nutrient or another. But for some reason, she had been watching it every day. It was the only citrus tree in the garden that had a fruit on it. Gabrielle had actually brought this tree from Riverside 8 years ago. It was a navel orange tree, maybe the descendant of the original trees first brought to California from Brazil in 1873 and planted by Elsie Tibbetts. This was the sort of historic detail Gabrielle liked. Bringing an orange tree, no matter that it was probably a hybrid, from Riverside, California, to his place near Mazatlan, was a significant act of some sort. Gabrielle had taken some pains to plant the tree as a marker, to mark the Tropic of Cancer. Actually, there had been two trees, one on either side of the property, two points on a line. But one had died. Rafaela didn't think much about Gabrielle's fascination with an imaginary line, but she knew instinctively the importance of the surviving tree. The tree was a sorry one, and so was the orange. Rafaela knew it was an orange that should not have been. It was much too early. Everyone said the weather was changing. The rains came sooner this year.
What do they call it? Mused Doña Maria. Global warming. Yes, that's it.
Rafaela had seen it herself. The tree had been fooled, and little pimples of budding flowers began to burst through its branches. And then came a sudden period of dry weather. The flowers withered away, except for this one. Perhaps it had been the industriousness of the African bees, their furry feet dusted heavily in yellow pollen that had quickly mated the flower to its future, producing this aberrant orange. Not to be picked, not expected, and probably not very sweet. But from the beginning, Rafaela somehow felt this particular orange was special. Perhaps it was her desire to see a thing out of season struggle despite everything and become whole. As time went on, she found herself watching the orange, wandering out to the tree every day, even in the rain, feeling great contentment in the transition of its small growing globe, first from green and then to its slow golden burnish. But there was something else. Just where its tiny bud had broken through the tree's branch, Rafaela noticed a line, finer than the thread of a spider web, pulled with delicate tautness. It was most visible in the dewy mornings as the sun rose from the east. At other times, it was barely visible. But she always sensed its presence. If she could not reach out and touch it, she sensed its peculiar, very supple strength. Perhaps it was something like a thin laser beam or light passing through an optic fiber. Rafaela was not sure. She only knew that it ran across Gabrielle's property. In fact, she sensed that it continued farther in both directions, east and west, east across the highway and west toward the ocean and beyond. In the days when the orange was a blossom of soft petals, its fragrance surprised her. She had passed beneath the orange several times, drawn to its sweet scent before she had discovered it. The perfume could only be emanating from that curious flower. She came often then to secure the whiff that tingled her deep memory. It was as if she knew this scent intimately. It was then that she noticed the line. It seemed to shudder with pleasure, if lines could shudder with pleasure. And when the baby orange appeared, it seemed to grasp that line as its parent, if a line could be a parent. As expected, the orange did not grow to be very big or seem very succulent, but it did begin to hang rather heavily. And when the salty wind blew west from the sea, rocking it back and forth like a small cradle, the curious line, now running through the growing orange, rocked back and forth with it like a lullaby. Raffaella and Sol walked hand in hand past the orange tree, careful not to disturb the lizards and beetles waiting breathlessly beneath scattered leaves and brush. For 3 days now it had not rained, and yet any cool surface bled the air's moisture. Raffaella felt this wetness. It gathered in tiny molecules over her skin. It was a little before noon, and the sun was particularly bright and oppressive that day. If Raffaella had bothered to look at the calendar, she would have noticed that it was Monday, June 22. She might have also noticed the lunar signs in the corner of the calendar and the small print that said summer solstice. She glanced briefly at the orange with some satisfaction and hurried toward the house. "Come on, Sol. It's much too hot out here today." His little quick steps pattered behind, dancing around the young trees, and then ran forward. She followed Sol, who seemed to be following a path of his own. But upon closer inspection, he was tracing the path of a very thin but distinct shadow, stretched in a perfectly straight line along the dirt and sand. There were no telephone cables or electric lines above, nothing to cast such a shadow. And yet it was clearly there. Sol danced back and forth, his little legs jumping this way and that, over the soft sand and gravel, crossing the brick paths, hopping the line cut like a sharp blade across the earth. Raffaella glanced back toward the orange tree and the single orange, suddenly aware of the only possible and yet entirely impossible thing that could obstruct the intensity of the sun's light at this hour, slicing the heavy atmosphere with cruel precision. Indeed, the sun was a great ball of fire directly above the orange tree. It seemed even to point at the tree, at the strange line, at the orange itself. Raffaella ran after Sol into the cool shadows of the house. There was a sudden gust of tepid wind, and from the corner of her eye, she thought she saw the line's razor shadow dip away. South. Raffaella felt a dizzy nausea. She did not realize that the orange had fallen irresistibly from a height of 2 meters, rolling in dusty turbulence down a small slope, under the barbed wire fence, and just beyond the frontiers of Gabrielle's property, to a neutral place between ownership and the highway. Chapter 2. Benefits. Koreatown.
"Check it out, S.A. You know this story?"
"Yeah, over at Sanitary Supply, they always tell it."
"This dude drives up to Sanitary.
Makes a pickup like always. You know, paper towels, rags, mop handles, gallon of Windex, stuff like that. Drives up in a Toyota pickup. Black, shiny deal. All new, big pinche wheels. Very nice. Yeah, Asian dude. Kinda skinny. Short, yeah. But so what? Dark glasses, cigarette in the mouth. He's getting out the truck, see? In the parking lot. Big, tall dude comes by with a gun. Yeah, a gun. Puts it to his head and says, 'Give me the keys.' It's a jacker. Asian dude don't lose no time, man. No time. Not a doubt. Rams the door closed. Wham! Just like that. Slams the door on the jacker's hand. On the jacker's gun. Smashes the gun. Smashes the hand. Gun ain't worth shit. hands worth even less. Jacker loses it bad. He's crying, screaming. It's not over. Asian dude swings the door open, attacks the Jacker, pushes him up to the wall of sanitary and beats the shit out. Dude don't come up to the Jacker's nose, but it don't matter. Got every trick in the books. Bruce Lee moves. Kick, bop, whop. Damn! Don't mess with this man. By now, sanitary's called the police. Crowd's seen it all. Jacker's a mess. Blood everywhere. Never seen so much blood. But not a drop on the Asian. Not a drop. Never took off his shades. Never even stopped smoking. Turns over the Jacker's remains to the police. Don't say nothing. That's it. Goes into sanitary. Picks up the mop handles, Windex, rags. Gets in the pickup. He's gone. That's it. That's it. That's Bobby. If you know your Asians, you look at Bobby. You say, that's Vietnamese. That's what you say. Color's pallid, kind of blue just beneath the skin. Little underweight. Koreans got rounder face. Chinese is taller. Japanese is dressed better. If you know your Asians. Turns out you'll be wrong. And you're gonna be confused. Dude speaks Spanish. Comprende? So you figure it's one of those Japanese from Peru. Or maybe Korean from Brazil. Or China Max. Turns out Bobby's from Singapore. You say, okay, Indonesian. Malaysian. Wrong again. You say, look at his name. That's gotta be Vietnam. Ngu. Bobby Ngu. They all got Ngu names. Hey, it's not his real name. Real name's Lee Kuan Yew. But don't tell nobody. Go figure. Bobby's Chinese. Chinese from Singapore with the Vietnam name speaking like a Mexican living in Koreatown. That's it. Bobby's story. It's a long story. Gotta be after hours for Bobby to tell it. And then he might not. He was 12. His brother 8. Dad had a bicycle business in Singapore. Mother dies. Business went bad. Can't sell no more bicycles. Dad says, you want a future? Better go to America. Better start out something new. For the family, you better go. Don't worry about us. You start a future all new. Bobby's only 12. How do you get from Singapore to America? It's 1975. People getting on boats, rafts, dinghies, anything, swimming south of Vietnam, get to Singapore, but Singapore don't want them. They tell the Americans, it's your problem. Put them in camps. Keep them there. Count them. Sort them out. Ask questions. Americans lost the war. Gotta take care of the casualties. Call them boat people. Call them refugees. Call for humanitarian aid. Call for political asylum. Meanwhile, they're in camps. Singapore don't want them. What's America gonna do? Count them again. Sort them out. Ask more questions. Pretty soon, refugees get put on planes. Little by little. Distributed to America. Every day Bobby gets up early, he and his little brother, walk over to the camp. Gates open in the morning. Walk in. Stand around with the refugees. Eat with the refugees. Guards don't notice. Who's gonna notice? But he's there every day. Maybe he belongs there. So maybe they notice. Bobby and his brother, looking like orphans. Sad situation. Orphans everywhere. The war did this. Got to help the children. It's the children who suffer. Bobby and his little brother don't understand nothing. Don't understand Vietnamese. Just get some language here and there. That's all. Looks like they can't talk. Why not? War does that. You can't talk. Gets to be nighttime. Bobby and his brother go home. Slip out. Walk back into Singapore town. Go home and eat. Sleep. Get up early. Go back every morning. Spend the day sitting and eating with refugees. It's like that every day. Every day for months. That's it. Then, pretty soon, Bobby and the brother get counted. They get sorted. Get questions. Bobby's gotta have a name. He says, Ngu. Everybody's Ngu. He's Ngu, too. He's on the list. He's counted. Brother's counted, too. Get their pictures taken. Get some papers, American passports. Bobby's dad gives him money, U.S. money, saved from the black market. Hides it in his pants, sews it there. It's everything his dad can give. Money's there, ready, just in case. Every morning, Bobby gets his brother up early. Every morning, they slip into the refugee camp. Every night, they slip out. One night, they do not come home. One night, Bobby's dad and the two sisters eat dinner. They leave two bowls out like always. They stare at the bowls. Silent. Staring at the two bowls. Bobby'll tell you the story. But only after hours. After some beers and lots of smokes. He don't have time to tell stories. Too busy. Never stops. Got only a little time to sleep even. Always working. Hustling. Moving. That's why you beat that guy up and never stopped. Just kept on going. Never stopped smoking either. Gonna die from smoking. He can't stop. Daytime works the mailroom at a big-time newspaper. Sorts mail nonstop. Tons of it. Never stops. Nighttime got his own business. Him and his wife. Cleaning buildings. Clean those buildings that still got defense contracts. Bobby's got clearance. Got it for his wife, too. Go around everywhere. Dump the stuff that's shredded. Wipe up the conference tables. Dust everything. Wipe down the computer monitors. Vacuum staples and hole punches and donuts out of carpets. Scrub the urinals. Mop down the floors. Bobby only stops for a smoke with the nighttime guard. Bobby's wife likes to study. She's got a Walkman in her ears. Running the vacuum and the Walkman. It's not music. She's studying English. She's Mexican. Bobby don't teach her English. Speaks to her in Spanish. She's got to learn by herself. She's smart. Really smart. Got her degree at LACC. She told Bobby, janitors like them gotta make better money. Gotta get benefits. Some don't even get the minimum. Can we live on $4.25 an hour? No way. She joined Justice for Janitors. Bobby got mad. This is his business. He's independent. All the money is his. What's she talking about? It's solidarity, she said. Some work for the companies. They need to organize. For protection. Bobby don't understand this. He says he works the morning job and gets benefits. Why is she complaining? Maybe this was the reason. Maybe not. Bobby got in an argument with his wife. So she split. She took the boy with her. Drives him crazy. He can't see straight. Never been so happy as when he got married to that woman. Can't explain. Happier he is, harder he works. Can't stop. Gotta make money. Provide for his family. Gotta buy his wife nice clothes. Gotta buy his kid the best. Bobby's kid's gonna know the good life. That's how Bobby sees it. It's not just the kid and the wife. Bobby's gotta send money to his dad. Back in Singapore. Keep the old man alive. Wanted the old man to come to LA, but he wouldn't do it. Says he's too old. Says Bobby's got the future. All new future. And Bobby's baby brother. He's in college. Smart kid. Gets all A's. Bobby put him in college. Pays for everything. Books, dorm, tuition, extras. Got him a car, too. Bobby don't forget his baby bro. His carnalito. Don't forget the kid cried every day when they arrived. Every day for 2 weeks. Cried for his mom, who was already dead. Cried for his dad. For his sisters. Cried. Carnalito don't cry no more. Bobby don't forget. Used to be back in Singapore, Bobby had it easy. Dad had a factory. Putting out bicycles. Had a good life. Good money. Only had to go to school. One day, American Bicycle Company put up a factory. Workers all went over there. New machines. Paid 50 cents more. Pretty soon, American companies selling all over. Exporting. Bicycles go to Hong Kong, go to Thailand, to India, to Japan, to Taiwan. Bobby's dad losing business. Can't compete. That's it. But that's the past. Everything had to change. Change like the seasons. Rainy season, dry season. Rainy season will come again. Bobby's working on it. Gonna flood with the rainy season. Gonna fly back to Singapore and see his dad. Gonna see his sisters, see his nephews and nieces. Gonna bring the kid bro and the family along too. But he's gotta get that woman back. Gotta bring the boy home. Can't be happy without his family. Can't work. Can't keep running. Can't keep fighting. After hours, Bobby keeps thinking, what's he gonna do? Rafaela said he's gotta stop smoking. That's it. After hours, Bobby goes home. House is in Koreatown, edge of Pico Union. Maybe it's Koreatown, but he owns it. Stucco job with two palm trees in front. Nobody home. Just him. Woman said to stop smoking. That's it. That's the last cigarette. Boil some water. Get out the ginseng. Get a good piece of the root. Grind it up good. Hot water. Ginseng. Steam goes up just like the root. That's the smell. Clean up the system. Clear the head. It's an old root. Takes a long time to grow. Don't waste it.
Chapter 3. Weather Report. West Side.
That film noir stuff is passé. Don't you get it?
Emmy told Gabrielle over her Bloody Mary.
She squeezed the lime, dumped it in, shook in the Tabasco, more black pepper, and stirred the whole mess with the celery stick, licking her fingers, watching him, watching the waiters, watching the cocktail hostess walk away, watching the entire clientele in the restaurant, taking hold of the situation as if she had produced it herself.
Stop being such a film buff. Raymond Chandler, Alfred Hitchcock, film nostalgia. I don't give a damn if Chinatown, The Player, or everybody in Hollywood owes these old farts their asses. I'll give you this, at least they're in color. Except for Roger Rabbit. If I have to spend another evening with you viewing another video in black and white, this relationship is over.
She laughed, tossing the silky strands of her straight hair over her padded shoulders. She didn't mean it. She never did. She had started dating Gabriel because he was Latino, part of that hot, colorful race, only to find out that, except for maybe his interest in tango, and even that was academic, he wasn't what you call the stereotype. But that was back in college, the things you learn in college. Since then, they had been on again, off again. And considering someone like herself, so distant from the Asian female stereotype, it was questionable if she even had an identity.
Hot colors, she said, sipping the Bloody Mary. Color TV. When I was born, black and white TV was already passé. Monochrome monitors are passé, for God's sake. The other day I saw a 30-inch Super VGA. Know what it looks like? Like my hand. Here.
She pointed with the celery at her other hand, at the big ruby ring in the red nail polish.
Next step is high def. You know what I say?
She stopped scanning the ongoing surrounding scene long enough to look Gabrielle in the eyes.
Colorize them all.
Emmy watched Gabriel's reaction, watched his dark eyes under powerful brows, the aristocracy of his ink and nose, his trim goatee. Wouldn't you know it, his lips turned into a subtle grin. He was chuckling. Maybe he was even secretly hoping that everyone in the restaurant could hear Emmy. They were all an assortment of Hollywood types, screenwriters, producers, wannabes, gophers of varying dispositions, moguls of varying degrees of power or lack of, graduates of the UCLA Film School. Here they were at the very center of the West Side power plays, cushioned in pastels and glass bricks and remakes of David Hockney, and she was trying to be obnoxious. And he was smiling. Go figure. Emmy looked at her watch.
Don't worry. I can take a long one today. Only I gotta be back to segue the weather report. Can you believe it? We got a sponsor for a mid-afternoon cut to weather report. 90 seconds. Didn't want the heat of anything controversial, so probably suggested weather. Also, ultra-cheap time slot. Not to mention short. In LA, how can you lose? Monday, overcast in the morning, sunny in the afternoon. Tuesday, overcast in the morning, sunny in the afternoon. Temperature holding at 78 degrees. That's what's wrong with your precious LA detective films. It's always raining. It never rains here. The only reason it rains in those films is so Bogey can wear a trench coat. What's the point? It's like those freeway signs that tell you you're in traffic. So what's new? It's either overcast or sunny. And you know who bought the slot, don't you? Some tanning lotion company. Summer's over and it gets dumped.
Summer solstice today,
Gabrielle mentioned, since the subject seemed to have changed to the weather.
I was thinking about my place in Mexico. The Tropic of Cancer runs right through it.
He picked up a knife and sliced the air.
That means the sun is right there, directly on top of my place. Now.
He looked at his watch.
Does it affect broadcast reception?
I don't know.
Gabrielle shook his head.
I thought the sun could do that. Why am I asking you? I should ask one of my technicians. On the other hand, I shouldn't. You ask a technical question and you want a yes or no. But these guys are starved for any little talk. They'll technolize you to death. Really, they get off on it, like sex. All I want to know is if my program is going to get up, and for God's sake, don't screw up the commercial.
Gabriel sipped his water.
At least order Perrier. This is on me, you know. I'm expensing this one.
Emmy crunched into the celery and waved around the stringy end of it.
Order a Sauvignon Blanc. Go ahead. For my sake, you could try to blend in with this crowd.
Blend in with this crowd. Blend in with all these white studio types. That comment should get his goat.
You blend in,
he quipped and pushed the glass of water toward her.
Try this. Tap water from Northern California. It's got a very subtle bouquet.
Emmy smiled. Being obnoxious with Gabrielle was a great pastime. She liked trying to push his buttons. For example, she liked trying to be anti-multicultural around him. Right in the middle of some public space, she might burst out,
"Ah, oh, you're so Chicano!"
Oppressing him with images of television was another tactic. He was such a film aesthete. It made her sick. Sometimes she really made him mad, and he'd cuss in Spanish. On occasion, he'd walk out. Oops, went too far. Oh well. But today it occurred to her that Gabriel was onto her. Onto this purposeful, for whatever purpose, display of obnoxiousness. He seemed to be sitting there waiting for it to pass. Her mother said her big mouth was always getting her into trouble and that it was no wonder any boyfriend didn't stick around very long.
What's the matter with you? Your dad and I don't talk like that. Your brother and sister don't talk like that. In fact, no J.A. talks like that.
Maybe I'm not Japanese-American. Maybe I got switched in the hospital. There were three sets of switched kids on the daytime Donahue's last week. Montel Williams, Ricky Lake, and Sally Jesse Raphael.
Ratings were all up. Caress sold a lot of Caress. But get this, they discovered each other by genetic testing.
If three talk shows found three different sets, imagine how many more of us there must be. There's probably a support group out there for people like me. I should check the net.
It's your dad's genes, not mine. We suck guys keep our mouths shut. That's what. Besides, I like Gabrielle.
Really? I like Gabrielle too.
If you like someone, how can you treat him like that?
He can take it. Think of it this way. I'm not hiding anything from him. What he sees is what he'll get. It's really just a test. Rigorous, but hey, some fail. Like human feats on cable. Like paddling across the Pacific in a canoe, crossing the Sahara on bikes, climbing Mount Whitney.
It's more like jumping off Mount Whitney.
Emmy's mother rolled her eyes. It was useless to talk seriously about these things.
If there's one thing you and Dad taught me, it's that you can never appreciate anything that just comes to you. You've got to struggle for something to really appreciate it. Like when you made me make my payments on my Civic, or when I saved to buy my first Panasonic VCR. I really struggled. That's what Gabrielle is doing. Struggling.
The most Gabrielle was struggling with at the moment were the foreign words on the menu.
Pappardelle con funghi al vino marsala,
he muttered.
As menu items go, it's probably passé. But it is to die for, she suggested. I know the chef. Go ahead. Die.
Poisoned fungi?
He asked, attempting a mild joke. But she said,
Fugu. Fugu's poisonous. If you wanted Japanese, you should have said so.
Fungi.
He looked up.
Mushrooms. Fungi are mushrooms. Some mushrooms are poisonous.
She took a swig of Bloody Mary and licked her lips. The Tabasco burned her lips. She licked them again and puckered.
So? What? It's just a little oral gratification. Afraid to die?
No shit. I'll go to hell, and you'll be there with your big mouth dumping on me till eternity.
That's the trouble with you. Live on the edge, I say. Live to the max. It's like riding the crest of a wave, staying current with it, right there, on top, top of the news, before it breaks.
I'd rather be in Mexico.
You'd rather be in the 1930s, back in black and white with that detective Philip what's-his-name. It's not like I'm not interested in your habit. I mean, this Philip Morris...
Marlowe
guy could have a revival. Then okay. But otherwise, strictly current affairs for moi.
Gabriel had heard this harangue before. He didn't even seem to be listening. His thoughts were far away. He didn't try to defend his hero or even the possibility that a Chandler revival might be more than just a current affair. He knew that she knew.
It was just one of those absurd conversations with Emmy. He changed the subject.
I talked to Rafaela at my place near Mazatlan. I think I'm finally going to get the house finished.
That's great.
I'm thinking of going down in a couple weeks.
Maybe I'll go with you.
She reached down and pulled the electronic scheduler from her purse, entered some items on the screen, and said,
"You should get one of these. Then you'd have all my numbers and your calendar all together. I'm going to get you one for your birthday."
I like my calendar book better.
This is what the future is about. A paperless existence. Gabrielle, you're murdering trees.
She paused.
2 weeks from this one, I could get a Friday off. Make it a 3-day weekend.
I don't know. Actually, I'm thinking of driving. I may have to take some toilet bowls down.
Toilet bowls? What's wrong with Mexican toilet bowls?
Rafaela says they're too expensive.
I can't believe that.
That's what she says.
Gabe, this back to nature thing of yours? It's a nice vacation, but how about golf?
I don't know how to explain it. I get a kick out of planting a tree every time I go. It's not like this news business. I plant, I get fruits. I get to make something I can actually touch and eat for a change. Seriously, I sometimes think to hell with all this.
Gabrielle's eyes wearily surveyed all this. So did Emmy's.
I read somewhere that these days if you are making a product you can actually touch and,
she emphasized and,
making a comfortable living at it, you are either an Asian or a machine.
Suddenly a beeping. Emmy reached in her purse and turned it off. Then she scrambled with the rest of the contents in the purse until she found the folded cellular phone, pulled out the antenna, and punched in memory.
I knew this was going to be a weird week. We're calling it Disaster Movie Week. Every night we've got another disaster movie. Tonight it's Inferno in the Tower. Tomorrow the Northridge quake. Then it's Canyon Fires. Airport 3, bomb threat at the Pacific Exchange. Burn, baby, burn. And for the final insult, the day after. Can you believe it? The lives of ordinary people with petty problems who now have a big problem.
Emmy grimaced at Gabrielle and directed her voice into the phone.
You paged? This was supposed to be an easy day. Yeah, no, shit. Oh, shit. What do you mean you can't find the tape? I put it in your hands personally. Personally. Remember? That's not what you said. Okay, so what's the problem? What mix-up? We're not going to lose this. No way. Or it's your pay. You pay for the slot. Okay, I'm coming. I'll be there in 10 minutes.
She slapped the phone together.
Gotta go. You eat my linguine.
She pulled out a lipstick and a mirror, twirled up the baton, and quickly reformulated her lips.
Wrap it up, bring it home. Damn weather report. 3 minutes. Pre-recorded this morning. I saw it myself. Perfect for tanning lotion. Like I said, overcast in the morning, sunny in the afternoon. The second spot comes up in an hour and no tanning sponsor tape for the time. Damn.
She flung the purse to her shoulder and headed away from the table, rushing past the waiters with their steaming plates of pasta.
I'll call you this afternoon.
Gabrielle stared down at the pappardelle con funghi al vino marsala, the sweet fragrance of wine and rosemary rising, the delicate slices of wild mushroom limp and appealing coyly to his senses, just under and between the firm ribbons of pasta.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.